A recent report by the U.S. State Department paints a distressing picture of freedom of religion around the world. We'll take a look at it and discuss what should be done. Next on the line. This is On the Line, and I'm Aisha Tanzeem. Today we will discuss not just the state of freedom of religion around the world, but also the controversy between respecting freedom of religion versus other rights. Joining me in the studio is George Ayittey, president of the Free Africa Foundation. And with us in our New York studio is Anne Neumann, editor of The Revealer, a publication of the New York University's Center of Religion and Media. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you for having us.
I want to start with you, Anne, and with more of a philosophical question. When we're talking about freedom of religion, what are we talking about?
Well, it depends on what country you're looking at and what historical context. The report that came out yesterday, introduced by John Kerry, is a product of the United States and therefore a product of our own predominantly Protestant history. That history is a bit of a myth when you examine some of the things that Kerry said in his introduction. For instance, he called it one of our core American values, that it helped create our country, and that it's the center of our national consciousness. But I and a host of academics would argue that the Constitution doesn't address religious freedom, and that is what several people have called one of our civic myths. So this idea of religious freedom in the United States as wedded with democracy serves a particular purpose for us.
Okay, and taking also the broader concept, when UN talks about religious freedom, it doesn't just talk about people who believe, right? It talks about choice and changing religion, and even if you don't believe, isn't that right?
Right, and those things are stated at the UN and in that document, but I think that we also must always keep in mind who created these documents and how religion is defined. It's a very difficult thing to define. How do you separate religion from, for instance, ritual or culture? And don't these things change all the time? And so that definition would then also have to change. So whoever shapes these documents is also controlling the definition of religion, which can be problematic when you're trying to extend that to other contexts globally.
Okay, now George, coming to you, there are two African countries that are in the top tier. There are eight countries that are the countries of particular concern. So Sudan and Eritrea, are they particularly egregious? Tell me what Africa looks like right now.
Well, I think this topic is very important. It is important because it has to be taken seriously. If not, it's going to render a lot of African countries support. Like you mentioned, Sudan, Eritrea, but there's also ongoing religious crisis and violence in Nigeria, Mali, and even recently in Kenya and Tanzania. And it is a very serious issue because, it never used to be like this. Africa has always been, welcoming of various religions. In fact, there are so many religions, in traditional Africa. Let's remind our listeners that neither Christianity nor Islam is indigenous to Africa. Africa had its own traditional religions as well. But there was, a great deal of religious diversity.
So what has changed?
I think what has changed is when the state gets involved. Africans have always been free to practice whatever religion that they want. But when the state gets involved and the state tries to favor one religion over the other, and that's when the problem starts. And especially in Sudan, for example, we've seen that, that kind of policy where the president of Omar Bashir vowed to establish and implement a Sharia law led to the breakup of Sudan. And also in Nigeria, where you had northern governors, this was way back in 1999, insisted on declaring the Sharia their state religion, even though that contravened the constitution. now started this whole, you know, a slippery road to Boko Haram and all this, you know, Islamic militancy in Nigeria.
A very important point that George has raised, that when you bring state into the religious mix, it leads to a whole lot of problem. A lot of people ask these questions, particularly people who are living under states that are declared to be under a particular religion. Is it really bad to have state involved with religion, or is it just the implementation of it that can go either good or bad?
I think it's probably a terrible combination of both. If you have a state that is defining the normal way of living for a population, there are always going to be problems because we don't all believe the same way, we don't all live the same way. So state dictation of that behavior is very, very dangerous for some citizens in different nations. But it depends again on the context. If individuals are allowed to name their own religions in this, I would say, semi-nostalgic idea that the professor just mentioned, that prior to state intervention, Africa was a host of tribal religions. I think there was probably quite a bit of trauma and strife there as well, although perhaps it was attributed to a host of different reasons. Here we are in an era where we have states that are saying this religion is defined as such, so a very static definition. And then the policing of that, or those definitions, are then used to promote, division that would have in the past fallen along class lines or racial lines or other minority separating
economic lines. Yes,
absolutely.
Now religion comes in. George, globalization is increasing around the world. We say the world's becoming a global village. Is it increasing religious tolerance or decreasing it?
Well, you know, it's you know, in a way, it's good that, you know, we're having the media spread, you know, word around, you know, word gets around very, very rapidly. But then, you know, we have to make a distinction between religious freedom and religious tolerance. And it's important. Well, it's an important distinction because, you know, I think most people will accept the fact that, you know, you're free to practice whatever religion that you want. You know, it's an individual or, you know, personal, you know, decision for you to make. But, you know, when you are intolerant of other people's religion and when you want to impose your religion on others, either through, you know, by coercion or through force, that is when, you know, problems start, you know. So in a way, you know, you can have, you know, we have the internet, we have, you know, et cetera, you know, we can spread, you know, our religious beliefs around. But when you want, when you start using the same medium to demonize other religion, then we'll have problems.
We get into trouble. And what do you think is the role of globalization on religious tolerance?
Well, first and foremost, I'll have to say that I abide by the concept of free speech. Always. And so if there are individuals who are defaming other faiths, the best antidote to that is clear conversation. So I think that blasphemy laws, for instance, in parts of the world have proved incredibly problematic because they're instituted by governments or legislating individuals who have their own political and economic and religious agenda. So I would step away from perhaps legislating how we speak about our faith in the public square because we have seen that these laws can be very detrimental.
Now, and again, you bring us to another good point, which is how do we balance religious tolerance, religious freedom with other kinds of rights? You mentioned one right, which is freedom of speech. We see even in U.S. there are gay rights, there are a debate on abortion, there's a debate on whether birth control can be provided. George, how do we balance it?
Well, you know, I think what has been missing in a lot of this debate is just, you know, maturity.
Okay.
In a sense that, look, we all understand, the bottom line is we all understand that we have, you know, freedom of expression. But, you know, but you don't go to a crowded theater and shout fire. You know, that is totally irresponsible. At the same time, you know, you got to recognize, you know, that, you know, whatever that you say, you know, take a look at Canada, for example. in Canada, the Canadians would not give you a visa if you want to come to Canada and incite racial hatred or even religious hatred. Okay? So is that equivalent to blasphemy laws? I don't think so. But you see, the Canadians have been more responsible in trying to, you know, ensure that, okay, people have freedoms, but they exercise these freedoms responsibly.
And what do you think? I mean, this debate goes on in U.S. all the time, but also in other countries. For example, I mentioned gay rights. There are other things. One religion allows multiple marriages. Some countries don't allow it. How do you balance individual rights versus religious freedom, religious tolerance?
Well, I'm going to stay out of the marriage question because I'm not quite sure what the investment is for any government to regulate particular issues in marriage. That would have to fall to the particularities of those places. But definitely, I think that if you look at the report, again, an American-produced report that has its own history that I hope we get a chance to talk about. But if we look at the report, which doesn't examine issues of religious freedom in the United States, I was able to pull out a few cases where the United States did not acknowledge some religious freedom violations. For instance, if you look at Ireland, some issues regarding health care, a woman died last year. Her name was Savita Halaponarov, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but she was unhealthy, pregnant, and was not able to carry the fetus to term. And because the hospital there did not provide her with a timely and necessary abortion, she unfortunately died. And so I think clearly the religious laws in Ireland prevented the performance of that abortion. And I don't know, except in the United States, where that kind of violation of religious freedom would not be documented.
We have to take a short break here. We'll be right back.
Voice of America. 1,500 hours
of news and information,
educational and cultural programming
to more than 134 million people
worldwide each week.
Listen to us on radio.
Watch us on television.
Follow us on Facebook or Twitter.
And through your mobile device.
VOA.
We're dynamic
and consistent
in bringing you the most reliable information
in 43 languages.
Tune in.
Tune in.
Welcome back to On the Line. I'm Aisha Tanzeem. We're talking about the state of freedom of religion around the world. My guests are George Ayittey, president of Free Africa Foundation, and Anne Neumann, editor of The Revealer, a publication of NYU Center of Media and Religion. Now, Anne, you were going to give us another example, but I'm going to ask you another question, and let me come to you for that. How do we balance, again, I asked that, how do we balance freedom of religion, tolerance of religion, and, you know, other rights? For example, in U.S., the Obama administration says you should provide birth control to everybody. Those who believe in Catholicism say we don't believe in birth control, so why should we pay for it?
Right. In the past couple of decades, we've seen a move toward honoring a freedom of religion and freedom of conscience, and reinforcing that for institutions as opposed to individuals. In the United States, the Vatican, as represented by the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, has worked very hard to paint Obamacare or the new health care law as a violation of religious liberty, and they use the word liberty. Because what it does is provide services to individuals regardless of their faith. What the church would like to do is police the access to contraceptives for their employees. So
again, like you said, you know, church is on one hand trying to safeguard what they think are their interests, and the government's on the other hand trying to safeguard what it thinks is the interests of the citizen. George, I want to come to you. We see this around the world. We see it in Africa, we see it in Asia, we see it in the U.S., this battle between trying to balance rights.
Yes.
Do you, where do you think it's going, and how do you think we should address it?
You know, one of the things that, you know, we've learned in Africa, and again, is when people try to use the machinery of the state, okay, to at least, you know, to influence the way they think, you know, other people should, you know, behave or what type of beliefs they should have. Then we run into problems. But then the thing is, see, in other parts of the world, you know, here in the U.S., for example, you know, we can have an open debate because it's an open society. Okay? But in other parts of the world, say in Africa, for example, where the societies are much more closed, there isn't, you know, this tradition of open debate so that only one particular point of view gets heard. Okay? That, to me, is very dangerous. And I think not only is religious tolerance important, but we should also have either open forums where, you know, we can dialogue, where, you know, we can find solutions to before, you know, we clamp down and before things blow up. Yeah, I mean, you look at, you know, Mali, for example. Things were simmering for a long, long, long time until everything blew up.
And what interests me and what is that there is a particular report on the state of religious freedom, whereas the State Department also puts out another report on human rights. Why is religious freedom so important that it's separated from the other human rights in a report by itself?
Well, I mean, we're talking about the way that the United States thinks of itself. In Kerry's introduction yesterday, he also quoted John Winthrop, who turns out to be a distant relative of John Kerry's, which was news to me. But Winthrop's quote is about America as a city on a hill. And so this concept of the United States as a shining beacon to the rest of the world, where religious freedom is inherent within us, and that the United States is here to not only protect its own citizens, but that religious freedom of citizens across the globe. And this idea of religious freedom and our mission as extending that to the rest of the world is kind of a form of American exceptionalism. So here we are to define religious freedom for other states and other countries,
telling them what other people should do. George, does it help America going to different countries and saying, you're not doing this right, you're not doing this right, this is how you should do it?
Well, you know, this is tricky. It is tricky in the sense that, I mean, look, right now we live in a global village, and we come to the village with different traditions and different types of religious beliefs and so forth. So even if you, let's leave the U.S. out for a moment, you know, basic common sense, you know, says that, you know, we should at least, you know, practice religious freedom. Otherwise, you know, look, we came from a colonial rule. Otherwise, you know, we don't want, you know, imperialistic imposition or neocolonialistic imposition. Even those of us from Africa should say that we should practice, you know, we should respect religious freedom and so forth. It is not the U.S., okay? Now, let me emphasize this. It is not the U.S. which has to preach this to us.
Everybody knows that.
Everybody should know that. Even in our own African traditional history, we've always had religious freedom and incredible religious diversity.
And we talked about whether globalization is making religious freedom more tolerant or not. Is there more religious freedom today in the world than, let's say, 100 years ago, or is there less of it?
I have no idea, and I don't even know how you would measure that. Again, the concept is relatively new to us. And I do want to make one point that the way the United States conceives of religious freedom is incredibly important to the rest of the world, some would say unfortunately. In the way that this report then dictates how resources from the United States are spent around the globe. And those resources include funding, healthcare resources, even military might. I mean, again, the report was introduced by the Secretary of State, who forms our global policy. So while I would like to I would like to see a world where local individuals can make their own conscious decisions about faith. I do believe that it is a global theater, as the professor says, and we're unfortunately tied to these larger structures of resource allocation that have huge ramifications.
You agree with her?
Oh, yeah. I do agree with her in the sense that, look, the main thing is having the U.S. promoting, pushing.
For example, I remember the anti-AIDS drive in Africa was severely affected by religious beliefs of certain countries because they wouldn't pay for condoms.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's not just, condoms as well, but even the HIV infection. There are some people who don't believe that, antiviral, drugs will help them, because of their religious beliefs. I think, we can make allowances for such situations, but I think the bottom line is that, we have to have, religious freedom, religious tolerance, and people should have, the opportunity to dialogue whenever there is a problem, okay? We don't have that kind of opportunity. In fact, in far too many cases in Africa, And I'm not just picking on Islamic, militants. We've also
had... In a lot of countries, people don't talk. I mean, Burma is an example. China is an example. Now, I wish we could keep on talking about this, but we cannot because our time is up. I want to thank our guest, George Ayittey, president of the Free Africa Foundation, and Anne Neumann, editor of The Revealer, a publication of NYU's Center for Religion and Media. And thank you for joining us. Please send us your questions or comments or watch our past shows on our website, voanews.com/ontheline. We look forward to hearing from you and hope you'll join us again next week for another episode of On the Line.
Feeling disoriented? That's actually the point. Otherwise,
it just looks like realism, and that's the one thing in the world that interests me the least, I would say.
Welcome to the world of artist Tony Dove. We're at her Tribeca studio where art meets geek.
It is geek central. I call Lucid Possession a geek opera.
Lucid Possession is somewhere between performance art, film, and a musical event. Projected images, some of which seem to have a life of their own, are paired with onstage performers. It premieres in April, but today we're getting a sneak behind-the-scenes peek.
The main characters all have these very iconic glowing costumes.
That's an LED-infused skirt.
So they're almost like graphic novel characters that way. They never change their clothes.
There are 3D mechanical projection screens.
It's just very carefully designed so that an image fragments on it in a particular way that makes it appear very dimensional.
There are robots and cyborgs, both digital and material.
You know the difference.
Or do you?
This video puppet uses vocal analysis based on a particular performer's voice.
Voice recognition software translates speech into the video puppet's mouth movements.
That allows the project to lip sync live.
Dovener collaborators also built a custom motion tracking interface.
Yeah, it's all based on Macs, MSP objects, and Jitter.
As stated, Geek Central.
It's a programming language that lets you build your own software.
Basically, infrared cameras pick up doves' movements.
This is the image the camera is seeing. And then these four black bars are histograms that show just what's moving.
That motion controls the movement of the videos on these screens, so these digital characters can be animated on the fly during the performance.
If I freeze like this, everything stops. Now I'm moving her arms on the floor, and if I do both at once, then both her arms and legs are moving. It was like dancing a movie.
The protagonist of the story being delivered through all these different channels is a woman named Bean,
who's a programmer and a designer of smart personalities. And she's created an avatar that's gone viral on the internet and brought her an enormous amount of attention that she's having difficulty managing. And she's so deeply engaged in her programming that it gives her almost paranormal skills. She has a head like a live Twitter feed without the technology.
Does this seem out there? Dev sees the subject matter and the way the story is delivered as mirroring modern life.
It's about the way in which we are all living simultaneously in many registers at once, in between the real and the virtual. And that gives us a sense of extruded identity, I think. This is Hoffman.
As I'm sure you noticed, Dove makes the kind of art that's not easy to categorize, and that runs in the family.
I come from a family of artists, and my grandfather was Arthur Dove, who was one of the first, well, the first American abstract painter. Probably in the family DNA was the idea that, you know, that it was okay to get off the path with a machete. Basically, I've been working for 20 years developing different forms of interactive narrative storytelling. It's like I'll look at a movie and then the impulse will be to take it apart like it was a pocket watch and have all the pieces on the table and then think about different ways it can be configured.
It's something you put together. You can take it apart.
It's fun. It's my work is a party I get to go to every day.
We'll update you on where and when you can see Lucid Possession closer to the premiere. For Science Friday, I'm Flora Lichtman.
Three, two, one. How research from space could help scientists here on Earth stop a killer and make food safer around the world. Stopping Salmonella next on Discoveries and Breakthroughs. When people started getting sick from salmonella-tainted eggs several months ago, it made Lisa Eshelman think twice.
I wasn't sure which way to go with it. Should I just toss them?
After the big scares over contaminated eggs and peanut butter, she tries to be extra careful.
Oh, I definitely don't want to endanger the family. I mean, you know, you'd rather be safe than sorry as far as that goes.
Salmonella is the leading cause of bacterial foodborne illness in the U.S. and the leading cause of death from foodborne illness, but we still don't know how to stop it.
This bioreactor is oriented to grow salmonella in a spaceflight-like environment.
Arizona State University microbiologist Dr. Cheryl Nickerson is sending the bacteria out of this world.
Three, two, one.
When two shuttle missions carried salmonella specimens into space, researchers made a surprising discovery. Salmonella grown during spaceflight was 3 to 7 times stronger than when grown on Earth.
Spaceflight uniquely increased the virulence of salmonella. It made it a better pathogen. It was better able to cause a disease at a lower infectious dose. So it was a better pathogen in flight.
Researchers say understanding the genetic switches that change the disease-causing potential of salmonella in space could be the key to finding a way to stop it.
If you know what's causing a bacteria to be more virulent or less virulent, that gives you important mechanistic insight that you can use here on Earth to develop a better vaccine or a better therapeutic to treat it.
Science from space that could one day make our food here on Earth safer. I'm Alex Kane reporting.
Vous êtes en Somalie, au Sénégal, au Nigeria, ou encore au Zimbabwe, de chaque coin de l'Afrique au sud du Sahara, vous pouvez nous faire confiance pour vous informer et trouver les experts qui vous aideront à améliorer votre santé. pour vous et votre famille. Le réseau Afrique Santé, c'est sur la voie de l'Amérique.